Welcome back to one more of our series of physiology concepts. And today we will be discussing the process of homeostasis. So what is homeostasis? Let's look at the definition. Homeostasis is a self-regulating process by which biological systems in the body tend to maintain stability by adjusting to conditions that are optimal to survival. We need to understand the meaning of maintain stability. It means that the body is always going to change. There's always going to be external or internal variables that will change within the body, and homeostasis will help to adjust these variables back to the optimal levels for survival. If this does not work, disease or even death can ensue. So what are the wrong definitions of homeostasis? Homeostasis does not mean that the body remains static. The body is always changing, and the function of homeostasis is to adjust back to normal physiological limits. Let's look at some examples of those limits or those variables, as we call them. An example is heart rate. Everybody has an average heart rate, and if it goes too much fast or too much slower than the norm, this person has some disease. The same for blood pressure. We have a set average of blood pressure, body temperature, some blood levels of substances such as glucose or calcium. So these are some variables that we're going to discuss in a minute. Now, who controls homeostasis? Two main systems in the body are responsible for regulating the homeostasis. First, the nervous system. Second, the endocrine system. Let's look at these. Let's compare them. How fast is the response of the nervous system? Very, very fast. So anytime there is disturbance in the homeostasis, the nervous system is going to be the one that will respond first. The response is very fast. The endocrine system takes just a little bit longer. How about the effect of the nervous system? The effect is very short-lived. The effect of the endocrine response stays a little longer in the body. How do these work? So the nervous system is going to produce a response using electrical nerve impulses. These are going to travel down the nerve fibers. At the end of the nerve is going to be the release of certain chemical substances called neurotransmitters. The endocrine system responds by producing, again, chemical substances called hormones. So the endocrine system consists of glands, and these glands will secrete the hormones. These hormones are carried by the blood, and they will produce the homeostatic effect. What are the components of homeostatic control? How does all of this actually work? There are three main components we need to remember. First, a receptor. Second, a control center. And then the effector. Let's start with the receptor. What is a receptor? A receptor is a group of sensors in the body, and these sensors will always monitor the normal physiological levels. If at any time there is disturbance in the level of this variable, this is going to be detected by the receptor, and the receptor is going to send a message to the control center. How does it do that? By means of afferent pathways. Now, the control center is going to take this information that it received, is going to process it and make a decision. how do I reverse those changes? And accordingly, the control center is going to send a message to the effector organ to make the changes in order to restore the balance. So the pathway again is, this is homeostasis. If there is an imbalance in the homeostasis, this is going to be detected by the receptors. Receptors will send a message via afferent pathways to the control center. The control center will decide what needs to be done, and accordingly is going to send a message to the effector organ via the efferent pathway. And now the effector organ is going to produce a certain response, and the response will bring back the imbalance to normal. It will correct it, and homeostasis will be regained. So we're going to look here at what actually happens in this area. How does the effector organ make the response to the change? The mechanism for restoring homeostasis is by using either a negative feedback loop or a positive feedback loop. Let's look at the differences, and then we're going to look at examples. In a negative feedback loop, the response is opposite the direction of the initial state change. In the positive, the response is in the same direction as the initial change. The response here in the negative, it will counteract or negate the initial change, and this is where the word negative comes into focus. The response here will enhance or reinforce the initial change. Examples of negative feedback that occur in the body is how we control body temperature, blood sugar levels, and blood pressure. There are much fewer examples of positive feedback, labor contractions during childbirth, and blood clotting. Let's look at this example of negative feedback. So this is the normal homeostatic level of blood temperature. If there are outside conditions that tend to decrease this norm below 98.6, which is the normal body temperature, there are going to be receptors, and remember, receptors are sensors. They will detect the change, the deviation from the norm, and these receptors will send afferent pathways to the control center. The control center for body temperature is the hypothalamus. It's an area in the brain. And the hypothalamus will want to regain the normal body temperature. So what does it do? It's going to do two things. Number one, it's going to cause a person to shiver, and this shivering is very rapid muscle contractions. These will produce heat. At the same time, certain stimuli are going to go to the layers of the skin where there are blood vessels, and there's going to be vasoconstriction of the blood vessels of the skin, and this will retain the heat in and prevent loss of heat from the surface of the body. And these two functions will increase the body temperature back to its norm. Again, remember, why do we call this negative feedback? Because the initial change was lowering of the temperature. The homeostatic mechanism is going to result in increasing the temperature back to normal. So these two are in opposite direction. Let's look at the positive feedback loop. And this is the example of what happens during childbirth. So when a mother goes into labor, the baby's head is pushing against the cervix. This will stimulate some nerve impulses that are going to travel all the way up to the brain. And in the brain, there's a very important gland called the pituitary gland. It will secrete a very important hormone called oxytocin. Oxytocin is carried in the blood and comes back to the uterus. What is the effect of oxytocin? It's going to stimulate uterine contractions. It's going to increase the contractions of the uterus. This will result in pushing the baby's head a little further down. This will push some more on the cervix. We have more impulses, more oxytocin, and so forth until the baby is delivered, and then this positive feedback loop is going to stop. Again, why do we call it positive? Because the initial change is increase, and the homeostatic loop is in the same direction. It will keep increasing until the final effect is reached. We're going to conclude by looking at one of the important outcomes if there is imbalance in the homeostatic mechanism. And this is a very famous example. We are looking at the normal blood level of glucose, and we're going to see if the homeostatic mechanism does not function, what can happen. So this is the normal blood glucose level. It usually increases a little after we eat anything that is high in sugar or carbohydrates. And accordingly, the normal homeostatic mechanism is, this is going to be detected, and the pancreas is a very important endocrine gland. Because of the high blood glucose level, it will secrete insulin. Insulin is going to go to the body cells or the liver. In the liver, insulin is going to pick up the glucose and store it, so it will lower the blood sugar level. In the cells, it's going to allow the cells to pick up the glucose and remain inside. So by those two mechanisms, these two effector organs, blood glucose level will go back down to normal. If this mechanism fails, somebody has high blood glucose level after a meal, if the pancreas does not function to produce enough insulin, or if the insulin receptors in the cells are not working, they're not receiving the insulin and they're not doing what they're supposed to do, this system will fail, and accordingly a person might have the famous condition of diabetes, and they might have to take treatment, medication, insulin, and watch their diet and so forth. Thank you for joining us. This concludes the presentation, and thank you for tuning in.